The TSW Roundtable is a proud member of the Star Wars Commonwealth Podcast Network. Follow at SW Commonwealth on Twitter and take your first steps into a larger world. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another but very special edition of the TSW Roundtable. I am Robert Cast, and today we are celebrating the life of our very good friend, Stephen Kirk, who recently passed in early August. And this is the roundtable. This is not a eulogy. This is just friends that knew Steve and friends that podcast with Steve and love Steve. And we're just going to celebrate our good friend Steve. So I'm not alone, fortunately. Joining us today is my good friend from the Generation X Wing podcast, Rob.
Hi, everybody.
Welcome, Rob. And of course, we can't celebrate Steve without his sidekick, the Robin to his Batman, his partner in crime at Chicago Celebration, my really good friend, Riley. Say hi, Riley.
Hello. How's it going?
Not too bad. So here we are. It's a somber occasion, but we all discussed this once we heard the passing of our good friend, and we were waiting for the appropriate time. And of course, immediately after, none of us were in podcasting form, obviously. Mm. And so, but here we are. We let a little time go by, and we're just here to share some stories and good times we had with Steve. So I'm going to go, Corey, how about you start us off? Like, where'd you meet our good friend and anything?
Well, you know, it all started when listening to his podcast. I'm like, wow, this podcast is crap. I have to meet this guy. from there, like, I went to some kind of, I forgot what bar it was. It was like a brewery, I guess, in San Diego. And I met all of the San Diego Sabres that were there. They're all dressed up like nice suits and everything. The food was free. The beers were awesome. It's like wine tasting and food taste. It was really crazy. But yeah, I met Steve the first time there. That was like, what, 2 years, 2.5 years ago, something like that, maybe. Yeah, fantastic time. And I knew right then and there, is like, this guy is, he's going to be my spirit animal for a while. So yeah, after that, it's just been a lot of like WhatsApp talking and stuff. I never made it to a San Diego Sabres like Sabre meet because I associated it with working out, and right. that's of course. Yeah, so, but other than that, yeah, it was a great time, and I'll never forget that time. But yeah, going over to his house and all this other fun stuff after that, just nonstop stories, man. It's pretty cool.
That's excellent, and yeah, and because you're a Knight of the Commonwealth, I forget which. Which podcast knighted you? Was it you, Rob? Yeah, he's raising his hand.
Yeah, it was me.
He knighted me on my own podcast.
But I had Steve was the first person I told because it was like fighting for custody. It was either Steve that was going to knight him or I was, and so we talked about it. And I mentioned to him that I was going on Riley's podcast, and Steve just gave me blessing. He was like extremely excited. I just remember how excited he was because it was pretty much, oh, if you're not going to do it, I'm going to do it. And I said, well, I'm here first. So
he was teasing me too. Cause he was like, oh, there's something special is going to happen to you.
Oh yeah. He would like, do that a lot. He would tease a lot.
He loved having, he loved knowing what you didn't know.
Oh, that's the best way of explaining it. And we'll get into more of that, especially when it comes to trivia. But yeah, he loved knowing something you didn't know. And you could tell there was a bit of an excitement around it, and almost sometimes I think he was rubbing his hands. You can tell on Twitter or something like that. He was rubbing his hands.
Yeah, but he was done in a way where it was like, I know this and you don't. It was done in, oh, I can't wait to let you know. So you're going to be so excited to know this as well, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's so true.
So Rob, your origin story with Steve.
Okay, first of all, like it's funny. The minute you hit record, I'm starting to like get reclamped. It's just as like I haven't thought about this in a while. I've been trying. Well, I think about him every day. It's weird. It's really weird, especially with the. I know you just asked me for my origin story. I'm already sidewinding.
Yeah,
especially with Star Wars, all the new stuff that's come out, and I'm just like, shit. I wish he was here to be a part of this, but. I say met, and every time I say the word meet, sadly, it's only internet met. I mentioned on my show, he's the best friend I ever met. And I hadn't met him personally, like face to face, but it feels like I did. I met him years ago when the Commonwealth, I think, was just about 4 or 5 shows, when it was just Talk Star Wars, Tumbling Saber, myself, Rogue Squadron, and I think Skyhoppers were with us as well. And I was doing scouting. I was just like going around without the blessing of the rest of the Commonwealth, but I was just scouting shows, and I was just going around and around and around, just checking podcasts, listen to an episode. And San Diego Sabres came up in my radar. I think, I don't even know how, like Twitter probably, or just I would just look for Star Wars podcasts. And there's only like 5 or 6 out there in the world. So I checked them out, and immediately his voice caught my attention. Immediately his energy caught my attention. His voice, his energy, his banter, his knowledge, the fact that his interest in saber combat fighting, and his general knowledge and the discussions that they had about what ifs and versus and stuff, I was just immediately drawn to, I need to talk to this guy and invite him part of the Commonwealth. He was relatively new to, like, his show was new, but his attitude and his cadence was not. He sounded like he was experienced. In fact, when you just said a little while ago that he had no experience, I swore he did. I swore he had experience doing stuff. And maybe it's because he did have experience doing other things, such as running cons and stuff. And he just seemed like a guy who knew what he was talking about and knew, he just carried himself as a professional.
Yes.
And so when I listened to his show, I was immediately like, listen, we like your show. We're trying to expand the Commonwealth. Are you interested in joining? And he was quite flattered, and which tells you he didn't, you know, I had him fooled, but it was like, he immediately jumped on it. Obviously talking with his all the boys and San Diego Sabres, and I'm so, so glad that he said yes, because he became a strong support, not only with the Commonwealth, but personally too. That's my origin story. So
yeah, he became a very powerful ally.
Yes, exactly.
And I'm going to touch on something real quick here, Rob. When you're saying, I mentioned this, I put together, I re-released a live podcast that Steve and I recorded in that Chicago celebration this year. Mm-hmm. And I put together a little thing, and I just, what I wanted to repeat for those that aren't a patron on Talk Star Wars, when you're friends with somebody online, and especially podcasters are in your ear for half an hour, 2 hours a week. It is a very intimate ordeal. And you become very attached to these people, even if you don't converse with them off online, but off the show. Mm. We've all had the privilege. I do this round table. So he was on countless times in the time that he was in the Commonwealth. And just because you don't meet somebody face to face doesn't diminish that friendship in any way. It's new as far as us as a human race is dealing with, but it's a special thing. And
especially our generation as well. I'm talking about me and Rob, not so much Riley. No.
But again, yeah, it's okay to feel, it's okay to feel, to suffer the loss. It's okay to mourn. Yeah. It's okay to, and cause I've felt that before when I hear of online personalities passing, and why am I so struck by this? Why is this hurt? And
cause you know, the person, that's why, I mean, you know them. Yeah.
Exactly. And we're going to get into more how we know Steve. My origin story was, again, Rob got him into the Commonwealth. And then
Nice job, Rob.
Yep. And I have this round table. And of course, I podcast with knights and showrunners and personalities from around the Commonwealth. And he came on, he was always up for it. There's a lot of times when we try to schedule these things, like even ours, you guys are out west and it's like, what is it? Oops, not even 8 a.m.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. It's almost 8 o'clock in the morning right now.
Exactly. Yeah. Like for, yeah. So for me, it's like Sunday. I mean, I'm just getting this done. I'll watch some football after whatever's going on. But so it's a real task to get these things going. And even though he was on the left coast and I'm out here by Toronto, he was always, yep. No, if you need an extra voice, I'm right here for you.
He was always willing to help.
Yeah.
It was awesome. Yeah.
So again, that's how I met Steve, and he came on Roundtables. I was lucky enough to meet him face to face for the first time. I have a 16-year-old daughter now, but at the time she was 15, and I it was a bucket list thing. Because we're from the Toronto area in Canada, San Diego Comic-Con is one of, it's like it'd be like us attending a Super Bowl or be like us attending a World Cup final. It's one of those things I just thought I'd never do, and then I said, you know what? I'm doing it because next year my kid's going to be 16 and she's not going to want to go on vacation with her dad. We got to do that together. And of course, Steve lives in San Diego. That's where I had a chance to hang out with him at that con. And it was like right away, I realized, oh, he's genuine. Cause when you meet somebody face to face, Riley, you know, like we were able to hang out. We had a great time, but
yeah,
we get to be more casual. We don't have to be all turned on like on a regular podcast.
Wait, what?
okay, maybe turned on is wrong. Okay. I apologize. Yes, I now I remember.
So, Riley's hitting on the guests. I can't believe it. The taste, Riley.
Well, you can't fault.
My fault. If this guy works out, you should see his arms. Like they're intimidating. All right. Dang. Yeah.
Anyway,
building the R2.
We're gonna save it for my celebration. You can go on about that. That's fine. So anyway, but yeah, Steve, he was the real deal. I was almost taken aback with it's like you're genuine. Like this is are you sure you're not Canadian? Because you were really
tight, right.
You know what I mean? Like
yeah.
And then again. We're going to get into this more Riley in a bit here, but, I had the chance to hang out with him at Chicago Celebration. Mm. And because Riley and the Rogue Squadron Pod guys and some of their patron listeners, you guys had an Airbnb. Well, Steve and I, Rob can understand this. We're of the older generation. So we're like, yeah, we'll go to the con with you, but we're not going to stay at the frat house. We need a place to go recharge, work on our laptops, and we'll meet you there at 10 in the morning.
First of all, I got to tell you, that frat house, it was super fun. But if you thought for a second that you're going to get a good night's sleep, nope, didn't happen.
I think that was his point.
That's why Steve and I had our own hotel room separately across town. Like, but anyway, and again, I got to hang out with, we were lining up. We got to see the Clone Wars panel together. We were close in age. We were running in the same gear. I remember walking around that con and he was looking for little tiki, little tiki ceramic cups. And he wanted a couple. And I'm like, he's like, oh, should I? I'm like, Steve, you're filling your suitcases with 100 things for everybody else, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Buy it or I'm buying it for you. Because I watched him for 5 days shopping for everybody else. No problem. Yep. No problem. And so he was able to do so. So we did. And he was so happy. And then when he goes to pick up something for himself, he's like, oh, I don't know. I'm like, okay, no, that's it. That's it. You're buying it. Yep. Period. Like this is happening or I'm buying it. Either way, this tiki thing is not going back on the shelf. that's the type of guy he was. I'm gonna throw back. Go ahead.
Oh, sorry. I was gonna say, try to buy that guy something. Just try. He will beat you up.
Well, yeah, I know. We've had arguments. We went for a steak dinner last night at Celebration. I go to the bathroom. I come back and the check. I'm like, where's the check? Because again, I was thinking, oh yeah, I'll grab the check or minimally pay for my, like, oh, don't worry about it. I'm like, no. And then, that argument, but it was genuine with him. He was like, no, Rob, I asked everybody to come out. That's it. Period.
Yep.
Okay. Well, that's wow.
Can I segue a little bit into that?
Of course. Absolutely.
Okay. This dude, I was online chatting with Rob Wade and Commander Cody and all that sort of stuff. It was that typical Twitter feed that goes on off air. And they're talking about Battlefront 2, and they're talking about how great it is or how it isn't and all that sort of stuff. And I'm like, oh, you must be nice. I don't even have a PlayStation to play it on. I can get you one. I go, what? And he says, you want one? I'm like, yeah. Oh, I was like, yeah, okay, sure, Steve, I'll have one. All right, it's on its way. And I thought he was bullshitting me. And then wouldn't you know it, about a month later, this PlayStation comes walking right into my door. I'm like, where the hell did this thing come from? And he just like, it's a gift. And he had mailed me a PlayStation. And I was sitting there like, I can't take this. And it was just like, you have to. It's been delivered. Yeah,
doesn't make you like want to just like punch him in the face. Like, why?
And I was just like, why? And I just stood there. I'm like, what? And even to this day, like my son knows, because I told when my son sees a PlayStation now in the house, he's like, where'd you get this? I go, a friend gave this to me. And he's like, he's awesome. I'm like, yes he is. And then just to like piggyback off that, a couple, about a year after that, I'm bitching and complaining about, I'm sorry, is there swearing allowed?
You can, yeah, go ahead. If it gets too blue, Riley, okay, no. I'll censor later.
But it's just like, I'm complaining about my mic as usual, because it's just frustrating and the audio and all. And understanding what it is to be an editor. I think all three of us do that. It becomes frustrating. And so he's like, his mind starts working. You can tell something's going on in the background. But then all of a sudden he's pulling strings and working together with the Commonwealth. And I know he didn't say it, but I know he had a big part of this. And if I'm wrong, I make a fool of myself, but he was, I'm guessing, the main guy behind giving me this mic that I'm speaking on right now, that Corey, the minute I went on air, you saw me. He was like, oh, there's a Zoom. Yeah. And it was just like, and this thing is just, this is a constant reminder of his generosity. And it's shit. The last thing we talked about was how to work this goddamn Zoom and yeah. how to work the mics and stuff. And he's giving me tips. And that was the last thing actually I got to pull up what he's, one of the last things he said to me. There it is.
Yeah.
Crap. And there's a picture of his fingers on how to press the buttons. And then
this is how you press a button.
Yeah.
Well, it was on how to press the buttons. But it's just like, and he said, this is how you do it. Oh, wow. It's simple. I'll try it tonight. And I go, thank you, master. And he's like, my pleasure, my Padawan. And that was the last thing he said to me.
Beautiful.
The last thing that we were talking about was through the WhatsApp. Cause like he WhatsApp me, I guess, texted me through that app like every single day, man. No, like it was like clockwork. Like we'd text each other, we'd send each other stupid photos or whatever it was, but it was an everyday thing. But the last thing that we talked about before he went on the trip over the weekend, we were talking about a midget wrestling show down in San Diego. Yeah. And like he was like, there's one right down the road. We need to go. And so I'm like, yeah, let's go. Let's go to the midget wrestling thing. I can't say midget, right? I can't. No, but no. Okay.
That's right. Fine. We understand. We understand
what it is.
Okay. All right. So
and Corey, sorry, Riley, you have similar stories with Steve and you mean stuff like, you know,
yeah.
You know, like it's amazing. Like he, the last thing Steve and I were talking about, because we worked at kind of doing that thing for the Commonwealth where we're trying to, you know, sponsor people to go to celebration. Mm. And we were working on the next one, right? You mean like, and that's what he thought about. Like he, when it comes to these things, like he was like, okay, Rob, okay, what we're doing this. Okay. Like, let's figure this out. Let's get, okay. What are we doing next? What's the next? It wasn't like, I talked to the Commonwealth. I'm like, hey guys, you know what we got to do next celebration? We got to get a booth. We can raise money for a charity as long as it's something we all agree on. But also, we're gonna bump up the Commonwealth and all the podcasts under its umbrella. Like, let's get some. And where else are we gonna get more target audience than a Star Wars celebration? Mm-hmm. And so I'm thinking. That's what I'm thinking about the next celebration. And of course, but his immediate first thought is, okay, what can I do for somebody else?
Yeah.
It was like, of course. And we're going to do this. And we're going to get the extra passes, whatever. But he was always somebody else first is what I'm getting at.
You know what he did? He was so generous with everything that he had especially with his money. Like, he would just, I don't know why, but he was a guy that was about, he told me it was about experiences, it's not about the money. So you can't feel bad about it. He wanted you to experience it. Yeah, when exactly. Chicago was my first Star Wars celebration that I've ever been to. I've never been to any sort of like celebration ever. And Steve was just hounding me. You got to go. All right, fine. Took the time off work. I made it happen. But he's like, this is an experience. I get to his house, ride my motorcycle. By the way, my motorcycle was all packed up, had like 3 backpacks. It was horrible. It looked disgusting. But I get to his house and like he was like, oh, we're going to go. And I'm like, Steve, we're going to be late. We got to go catch the plane at the airport. It's going to take us like an hour to get to the airport. And he's like, nope, just wait. He's like, here, have a drink. You know, we were drinking scotch at like 10 in the morning. But there's a friggin' limo pulls up. Like, this really, yeah. And I'm like, what the fuck? And he had like a personal, like a car service from his house to the airport. And then when we got to Chicago, there was the same car service waiting for us to bring us back to the hotel. When we got there, I was like, what the fuck? What is this?
He told me about this after. He told me how excited you were. And oh my God, he was like a proud father.
Well, yeah. I've never been in a limo either or any sort of car service. So it's like, oh my God.
I just have this image of you just like Jim Carrey with his head sticking out there like a dog.
Even at the airport, he brought us into like these little, what do you call that? The special rooms where they give you like free food and stuff that. Oh man. I was like, what the f-?
He told me about that too.
But it's like every single time I see him, like I didn't get to see him a lot just because we do live in like a town apart or whatever, but my work schedule was just horrible. And like when I did, I rode up to his house, but he would, every single time I come over, there was always something on the agenda to do. There's always something that we had to experience, so to say, like his whole scotch tour that he made me go through his last time, went through each type of scotch, you know? Oh my God. I was so,
sounds like he's an enabler. I'm joking.
I have 3 podcasts on my computer that I did with him, but we both got too drunk during the recording, so we started slurring our words and everything. We weren't able to post them because of that. So I mean, those are still on my desktop as we speak, you know.
And then we're getting on back to the podcasting. We discussed this before we started recording. Steve and I, I know the Commander Cody and Mopar from Rogue Squadron podcast, they set up we're going to record a podcast at Motor Road Brewing Company on the Friday. I think it was, everybody's just seen the episode 9 trailer and it was that evening. And he goes, you guys want to go on? And I'm like, okay, sure. We'll do a round table. And I thought that we were going to record in like a little booth and we're going to have the background bar noises as ambiance to the podcast. We walk into this place and it's almost like a comedy club kind of setup with people with a table at the front and Cody has the mic set up and everything's ready to go. And we knew there was a podcast called Force Toast with Alice and Laura from Chicago. So they were the middle show. Rogue Squadron was the last show and Steve and I were going on first. And I literally thought we were just going to record in a back room. Mm-hmm. And now here we are, in front of, I don't know, Riley, how many people, like what?
Yeah, it'd have been like 80 to 100 people.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You know, it's still a club. Yeah. The best way I can describe it is like in a comedy club type atmosphere. Steve and I have to go on first.
warm up the stage.
Warm up the stage and warm up the crowd. And I have a background. I played in bar bands and everything else. So I've had bandmates break a string. And I've just rambled on the mic and just talked to the crowd. So it wasn't that's how, and then when podcasting came into my life, it was, wasn't that much of a stretch. But Steve, here he is. And we just decided right off the top. I'm like, okay, are we doing a round table or are we doing a San Diego Sabres? And I know, and he knew right away, was that mean who's taking point? Mm-hmm. Who's going to be the moderator of this thing? Who's going to shift the conversation or just QB the whole, call all the audibles. And we agreed about, okay, well, let's do a San Diego Sabres because usually round tables are done with more people, this and that. Okay, fine. And then, okay, guys, you're on. Boom. And we did it. And again, there are better podcasts out there, but
hold on. I don't want to say, let's not compare that podcast to any other podcast because right. That was a phenomenal, you guys are bouncing off each other, making your old men. You made me like laugh out loud so hard that I was in the back of the fucking room and I was like, ah, like that. Like, and audio picked it up. You know what I mean? I'm like, dude, you guys were just,
That was Steve. And again, it was, that's how much of a pro he was. And I'm like, okay, we're going to do this. I'm like thinking, okay, you ready? Yep. No problem. And then bang. And then of course it wasn't like I do a weekly show with my buddy Roman. If we had to go live, well, that's not much of a problem because we go live, we live stream every week.
Right.
And we know each other for the last 30 years. But Steve, it's like, we've podcasted 2-3 times tops together. Okay, we're going to do this live show. Fine, no problem. And then total pro. It was just, I was so impressed. And it was like, oh, it was just what a fantastic thing. And now I have it. It's now I have this little thing in like a little time capsule. And it was the night that the teaser trailer for episode 9,
yeah,
all the excitement around it and all. And so I have this little moment in time with my good buddy Steve doing what we love to do. And it just, I'm so grateful. And I've said this before, I've said this to Cody, and I said, Commander Cody, I'm like, I'm so appreciative to have this now. It's just, it blows my mind. Rob,
you. I want to, you talked about podcasts. My favorite moments podcasting was whenever he came out to my show doing the GXW versus, and Riley was on one of these shows as well. In fact, there was the one where we did all the reuse questions.
Oh, yes.
So and he was the only one I told ahead of time because A, I knew he could keep a secret, and B, yeah, he would play along with it. So I hadn't told the gang from the Skyhoppers, and I hadn't told you, Riley, that this was all about reggies. And it was so much fun. It was so much fun. And he had fun with it. And his knowledge, one of the first things I remember about him when listening to his podcast in the beginning was his knowledge. And he would do trivia contests and at the pub and stuff. And so he was always willing to do the trivia, and it was amazing some of the stuff that he knew, and it was just, it was great. I mean, the last GXW I did, he won, and he never got a single question wrong, and he was stealing questions from other people. Ugh. And it was just so much fun. What I always got a kick of as well is when he was on the show, I would, okay, what question do you want? I would question 1, 2, 3, 4. And he would go, I would like to have question number 3, please.
That's a good impression.
He was always so polite, and I go, and he was always bringing the mature vibe of the room because there was a bunch of kids like Riley and Ash, and it was, they're all goofing around, and he's like, number 3, please, sir.
Yeah, yes.
Thank you very much, sir. It was my pleasure, and it was just so, we were just playing up the old guy, young guy sort of thing, and. Yeah. One of the things you may have noticed is on the shows lately, whenever I are on, for those who don't know our show, we do a segment called What Excites You. It's not every time, but it's on there. Yes. And we have a little sting that start the show, and there's all these little, Owen Wilson saying wow and stuff. Wow. But in the end, I did put him at the end. It was one of the episodes where he won the GXW versus, we have this trophy called the Kneel Before Zod trophy. And he's in the comedy, he's like, oh, Zod, my high overlord. And he was just so excited when he won. And so I kept that little segment in there. And that's what ends our What Excites You sting intro.
Yeah,
and it's guy. Just, yeah, he was knowledgeable, and he was so excited, and he was genuine. And it was always fun when he was podcasting on our show.
I always thought that he had, sorry to cut you off.
No, I was just going to mention, I just looked it up for those interested in that live podcast. It is on the San Diego Sabres feed on any podcatcher that you like. It's episode 104 and it's Motorola Brewing Company Live. So if you want to hear Steve and I ramble about being old and episode 9 trailers. So anyway,
that was awesome. I was just going to say that he always wore glasses, but I thought I had this theory that he had like an early prototype of like Google Glass. I can't even say that, how much he knew, just like it's feeding him the answers through his eyeglass. We just never knew. Cause he had every question. He's like, that reminds me of this. And then just, the way that he carried a conversation too, you could talk to that guy for hours all night. Yeah.
And he loved to, and again, he just loved to share knowledge, and it wasn't like, I know this and you don't. And he just loved when he got to see someone else learn something. Yeah. Riley and I, our last night at a celebration, we all went out to Michael Jordan's steakhouse in Chicago.
Sorry, Michael Jordan has a steakhouse?
Oh, yeah.
It's really good, too. Oh, wow.
It's unbelievable. And so we go, he messages everybody because we had a WhatsApp message group for everybody that was in the Commonwealth and at Celebration saying, we're going to meet me here. And guys, make sure you're dressed appropriately. Right. And it's like, because we're not going to McDonald's. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we show up and I have nothing appropriate because I can dress appropriately when I'm at home, but I was at Celebration. So I'm like, what's the cleanest shirt I have on me now? So
yeah, well, no one's going to tell you to dress otherwise with those arms. Let me tell you.
Oh, here we go. So anyway, now I'm losing my concentration.
Okay. Sorry.
So there's Steve. And who was El? Who was the young? What was his name? He was staying with you guys at the Airbnb. He was the frat boy. It was
Zale.
Zale, that's it. Sorry. I apologize, Zale, if you're listening. So there's Zale, and he's early 20s, and literally he is part of a fraternity in university. And for Rob and I, we don't have fraternities up here.
No, so, not really.
But anyway, your typical frat guy, football player. And he's showing him because he's having this meal and he's having this steak. And then he's like, no, what now? What you're going to have to drink is a porter. And then he orders the appropriate drink to go with it. And he's Zale's going, oh my God, this is amazing. And Steve is so happy. He's like, yes, my young Padawan. Like he's so happy to teach him. No, if you're at a higher class restaurant, this is what you order. And this is what and this accompanies this and this. And it wasn't done in an arrogant or, I know when you don't. It was just, you're going to want this later in life. And I'm so happy to tell it to you.
Yeah.
And the same meal, Riley takes a bite of his veal and he turns to me and he looks at me and goes, Rob, this is the best piece of meat I've ever had in my mouth. And now for those who know Riley, that came from Riley. Okay. So
it was a true statement though. It really was.
I'm like, okay. So
I don't know if you can hear the face palm that just happened.
Yeah. So again, that just another example, Steve. And of course, that was the meal that he grabbed the check and like, no, I invited you. So that's it. There'll be no more discussion.
Shout out to Dave, the waiter, by the way.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
He got a copy of the menu. He got, the hostess to sign it, including the waiter and the head chef. And they took a label. There was a Michael Jordan wine they have there that you can only buy at this restaurant. And they opened the wine. They shared a bottle of wine at the table and they had a label peeled off and they put it on the menu. And that's the type of guy he was. He was so appreciative. Like he's like, you're paying a fair amount of money for this meal, but he was appreciated everybody involved, waiter, hostess, chef, it was the experience.
Exactly.
Now in hindsight, for me anyway, that was the last time I saw him. And I don't think it would have mattered what we were doing. I was grateful it was a dinner with all of us there, but it wouldn't matter if we just saw each other at the next San Diego Comic-Con or whatever, or we met up somewhere in an airport lobby or having a drink in a bar. He made every time you saw him special, and he made everything an experience. So that's, it wouldn't have mattered where I saw him last. It would have been just as special as our the dinner we had together.
Yeah, I went to his house quite a few times, and we were just hanging out in gym shorts, just watching TV and drinking. Every time I saw that guy, it was nice. Exactly what you said. I mean, I was never bored. Like there was times where we could be like I brought my dog over to his house too, because his dog and my dog are pretty good friends, you know. So it was right. Even then, like, we could sit there and watch the dogs play and have just the most interesting conversations every single time I saw that guy. And it was something else, man. Yeah.
A couple of years ago, for those who don't know, I'm a school teacher, a middle school teacher, and there's some websites out there called Star Wars in the Classroom. And I follow it every once in a while, just check what's in there. And one time in my math program, I decided to involve Star Wars in my classroom. It's just this math program that I use called Mastering the Basics. And I was involving Jedis and the path of a Jedi, and how these kids would pass these tests and then go up to the next level of Padawan, then the next level of Jedi Master. And it was just a fun way to engage mostly the boys in my class, but I had quite a few girls that were engaged as well. And it was just, I was experimenting with something. I was talking to him about it. And this is earlier on in our friendship. And he was like, I run this thing called Intergalacticon. And I want you to come down, and I want you to put on a, what do you call it? Performance is the wrong word. Which I want you to put on a, like a clinic or something like that, and share.
Right. Like a TED Talk type thing on.
Yes. Okay. Let's use that. It's his version of a TED Talk. I want you to do that, and I want you to share what you do in the class. And I was like, you just met me. And it scared me, because I'm like, nobody wants to hear what I have to say. I got the podcast to prove it, but it's just like, it was odd, because I didn't know. Like, he was genuinely interested, and he genuinely wanted me to share my knowledge with others, and gave me a stage to do so. And stuff like that at the time made me nervous. It made me like, nobody wants to hear what I have to say. And then later on, he would like, he coming down to San Diego Comic-Con, I think it'd be great. He came up with some ideas, and I would just like, I don't know if I can do that. And then it's just coming down for Celebration, and I don't know if I can do that. And he's always trying to talk me in, and I'm always saying, I don't know if I can do that. It was just, and some reasons were legit. You know, my son comes first. But some reasons are because it's that same old mindset. It's like, I can't do that. That's not meant for me. I don't have the money. It's the excuses that you tell yourself. The same bullshit story you tell yourself every day, they say.
Yeah.
And after seeing you guys have so much fun at Chicago, and then he's telling me he got tickets for Celebration, and I'm just like, yeah, I wish I could do this. Why do I keep telling me I can't? Why do I keep telling myself I can't do that? And then he passed, and then I'm just like, I'm gonna fucking do this. And I'm it's just that thing that you're reminded of life being too short, and you don't know when. Yeah. So I kind of decided, so I'm sitting at an armor party. An armor party is where all the 501st members get together, and they build their armor and have a barbecue, and we're all talking. And my buddy Aaron and one of the co-hosts of my show, Terry, of the Outer Rim Rookie, those two guys are driving down to Anaheim. Tickets are already purchased, by the way. They're all gone, except for, you know, there's no tickets left. And Aaron's like, well, why didn't you come with us? And the first thing I thought about was, besides, I don't know if I can do that, was Steve, and how I missed out on an opportunity to meet him face to face. And I'm going to miss out on an opportunity to meet other 501st members face to face, other Commonwealth people face to face. And so I took him up on it, and I'm planning on trying. I'm working my butt off to try to get to Anaheim this year. I don't know how I'm going to get tickets, but that's a tomorrow problem. Right now, I'm going to be trying my best and a legit effort to. Scott will be taken care of. My son will be taken care of. Everybody's got, the world revolves away from me. I'm not as needed as I think I am. So take this opportunity for yourself. Take a moment in life and do something for yourself, and take advantage of a moment to meet friends that you've never met in person. Take advantage of experiencing something instead of just staying in your house. I am a man who's never left this continent. I'm a man who's never really, I've experienced wonderful things, but I know I've missed out on things. And one of the things I missed out on is meeting Steve face to face. And he can't take that back. So this is the biggest lesson that he taught me. And I'm going to be trying my best to get to Anaheim just to meet people like you guys. And I'm assuming you guys are going.
Oh, yeah.
everybody who's got a Stars podcast is going.
Apparently. And also too, I not to break your thought, but again, yeah. Passes, there's, we'll talk after the show. There are legitimate and without eBay or anything else. Don't worry. Like that's happening. You just make sure. You mean that there will, like I said, we'll discuss it after off mic, but
yeah.
But that there, that's, there's, it's easy. It's easier than you think. So just, yeah,
I know it is. Nothing. It's a ticket to a convention.
Yeah.
We're not talking about trying to find world peace here. But it's those moments that you miss. You can't get back, and you shouldn't allow a moment like this, like the passing of a friend, to teach these lessons.
Right.
But it was the last lesson he taught me.
Yeah.
So. Well, that's, and again, Rob, I am 100% with you. I was the exact same way. My wife, why would I spend my money on that? Why would I spend my money on this? Mark Godsiff, before Celebration Orlando rolled around, it was like 3 months before, and he's like, hey, you're close to Orlando. I'm like, well, compared to Mark, who lives in the UK, yeah, of course I'm close. I'm in the same time zone, but it's not close. And he goes, why don't you come to Celebration? Meet me there. I said, well, I can't do that. Again, it was the exact same thing. I am too important around here. Copernicus had to tell me, Rob, the world doesn't revolve around you in Southern Ontario. It will survive 4 days without you. But anyway, so I'm like, I'm having dinner or talking with my wife later that evening. I'm like, oh, I was doing a round table with Mark this morning. And he asked me to go to Celebration. And I wasn't hinting at it. I was just saying, isn't that crazy? She's like, well, why don't you? And you get, bear in mind, we just had a kid like a month before this conversation, mm-hmm. and Celebration was only 2 months away. And she goes, why don't you just do it? She goes, you got a passport you never use. Like, it just go. I'm like, wow, that makes a lot of sense. You mean, yeah, I wasn't hinting.
Surprisingly, right?
Yeah, I wasn't hinting at her. I went online. I was able to get, I wrangled myself. I couldn't get a 4 day pass, but I was able to find four individual day passes for Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I booked a room. I booked the flight. I'm like, yeah, it was pricey, but I'm like, I just did it. And I'm like, okay, yeah. I'm going. And now I have this memory of my good buddy Mark and I hanging out at, like, and Mark lives in the UK, and I don't know if I'll ever see him again. Like, so, but there, we have this, what a fantastic time. And I got to, even if Mark wasn't there, I got to go to Star Wars Celebration. So yeah. That's when I made the choice. I'm taking my kid to San Diego Comic-Con. That's when I'm not missing another Celebration, if pending, obviously, family tragedy or illness.
Yeah.
So I was right there with you, Rob. I was the exact same way. And then now, Riley and I met face to face when he walked into the 501st party. And Riley, he listens to my weekly show, which will tell you a lot about him. But and he's looking at me. He's like, he goes, "You're standing here." I'm like, "I know. Like, you're here. Like, you're right in front of me. You're Riley from LA. Like, what are you doing here?" and it would just, it takes a second to realize it's you.
Every single night too, that I saw you, I'm like, what the fuck? You're here.
I'm here.
I can hear the air. I can touch you.
Oh yeah, he tried.
I did.
And again, there was the same thing with Steve. When I bumped into him, I saw him at the Delroy booth buying other people signed copies of the latest Thrawn book. and filling up his bag on the preview night at San Diego Comic-Con. And my daughter was able to snap a picture of us together, our first meeting face-to-face. And again, that's Steve. And with that lesson that Steve taught you, Rob, or what you're taking from all this, I'm the same way. I joke on my regular podcast, I am the practicing atheist. Now, I'm not I don't put down other religions. I don't, I am an atheist. And practicing atheist, people are like, well, how do you do practice that? I'm like, oh, it's easy. I just don't. Anyway, so that's the running gag I have on my weekly podcast. And I am legitimately, I don't believe in the afterlife or anything else. That's why I'm so grateful for all these experiences that we're having now. And to me, the miracle is look what we have now. I with Steve, I knew him for 2 years, and I kind of had the privilege of hanging out with him, and not just at the mall. Like, we went to San Diego Comic-Con and a celebration together. Like, just like, I can't tell you, like, that's Mecca for guys like us. And so I'm so grateful for that, and I'm so grateful for what we have here. But what I'm also angry about is this guy comes into our life. I've known him for 2 years, and now I got to hopefully spend the next 30 or 40 years I got left without him. And it sucks. And I was angry, and I was in denial, and it hurt. But now, in hindsight, now that the shock is starting to wear, I can just be eternally grateful. And again, I do not believe in afterlife, heaven or hell, whatever you got going on. But I went to the Toronto Fan Expo a couple weeks ago. And I took my daughter, who's 16, and her friends. So they ran off, and I'm walking this expo alone. But I know lots of people. There's droid builders, again, the 501st, talking with other podcasters, meeting up with people. And Steve and I were very similar. Like, we didn't really want for anything. If I see something, I don't spend lavishly, but Rob was noticing I have like an animation cell of Prince Adam from He-Man cartoon. It was $30. Why did I buy it? Because it's cool. And I think it's cool. And like-minded people like Rob will think it's cool. But that's kind of for us. So Steve, again, you know, I was angry that I was supposed to arm wrestle you for that check in celebration. So I'm walking around this con, and then I see some buddies of mine. There's an exhibit, not advertised, Ripley's Believe It or Not. And there was a display, and for a donation that you make, and it was like $25 Canadian or something, but it was like, if you make this donation, we'll rope off an area, we'll pull this out, we'll hand you some gloves, and you will hold this lightsaber hilt from the scene in the Wampa cave that Luke used to force telekinesis for the first time to save himself from the Wampa and Empire Strikes Back. And I had this, 5 minutes with this thing. And then the guy's telling me, oh, you got to check this out. This is legit. I'm like, and I'm looking at it, and I'm looking at the markings that I know are supposed to be there. I'm like, yeah, you bought the right one. This is it. Like, and I don't believe, but something somewhere tells me, if Steve, what can I get Rob that he wouldn't? It was just, you know what I mean? It was just sounds silly, but it was like, I was walking around the con, and because my kids were off running around, and I passed by this tiki thing, and I knew he bought them for himself. And it was my first major con without Steve in a while. And I was kind of getting bummed about it. And then there's this lightsaber hilt of all things, you know, of course with the San Diego Sabres, you know what I mean? Like, there's a lightsaber hilt from an iconic scene from my favorite Star Wars movie. and there I am holding it. And again, I still deep down, I know it's not from him, but it was just so, wow. You
know what I mean? It's a nice mental connection and a nice reminder of a nice person.
That's just it. It's like, if this is any chance, if I'm wrong, he did that, and you know he did. You know what I mean? I'm not hedging bets. I'm not going, no. He's not going to convince me otherwise, but
that's a good one.
But
this is a pretty good argument.
But if you're going to, it was, and again, it was coincidence, but seeing a lightsaber hilt of all things from that movie, especially for guys, Steve and my and Rob's age, from that scene was just, I can't even, it made my con experience. I was bummed about Steve, and then I'm still bummed about Steve, but I got this gift from somewhere. Who knows?
Yeah.
Of me holding this thing, and it's I can't tell you what it, and yeah. And that those are the things. And again, what Rob was saying about making more out of life, taking these, screw it, I'm going to celebration.
It's hard to get to that mindset. It really is. Like, but if you just end up saying yes to one of those things, you'd be surprised on how different your life can be. Yeah. And it took everything out of me to go to Chicago. I was broke for weeks after that place. You know, I'm telling yeah. you, like it, but I will never forget that time out there. I'll never forget it. And I had it, like, you know, after he passed and everything, like I sent him like a bunch of messages because I didn't believe him. Because he's like, oh, I used to be in the Secret Service, or I worked for all these big companies. He always talked about like the no fly list and everything. I'm like, you're faking this shit, Steve. All yeah. right. So like I was in denial too, in a sense. But then like I had it as like a mantra in my head, because it, you know how he got the, pretty much like everybody, the Commonwealth got that, the Zoom for you, Rob.
Yeah.
This microphone that I'm speaking through right now, he got it for me too. And like I he's like, yeah, just pay me $60. You know what I mean? Pay me $60. I'm like, cool. I'll buy you like all the beers are on me next time we go to the bar and stuff like that. He never let me pay him back. And then on top of that, that was like a mantra that was going through my head after he passed. It's like, I'm never going to be able to pay this guy back. And it got.
You already did though, dude. Well, you paid him back through friendship. You paid him back through talking. You paid him back through just the aura of just being friends with him. I mean, that's yeah. how that's it's. Money is fleeting. It's the moments that last, and it's ironic because it's the moments that never stay. You can't physically hang on to a moment, but it's the thing that sticks with you the longest. Money will eventually burn away and go.
Yep. And I gotta tell you, like, I was so surprised because how Steve is, if how many people came up, it was like, Steve, you changed my life. Steve, you did this for me. Steve, you did that for me. It's insane how many people were out there. I did not even know, but he Intergalactic Con, his con that he had that he started. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I went there and oh my God, what a fantastic con. I love that thing. And there was every single person that walked through those doors, knew him, loved him, wanted to talk to him and be around him the whole time, which is insane. You know, he was just a well-known, well-versed guy. And I got to be honest with you, I would have never met him if I didn't find the Commonwealth. And I'm not, you know, I'm just going to say it flat out. It's not like a, you know, tickle the nuts of the Commonwealth or anything, but I would have never met him if this podcasting thing wasn't a thing. So, I mean, I am so eternally grateful to everybody in this awesome, awesome podcasting network, and so grateful to all the friends that I've made over the years. And he was one of the best, and that's it.
He was, you know what, Corey, that says it best. I mean, as far as final thoughts, I'm gonna throw it to Rob. Any last? Of course, we'll be talking about Steve for decades to come.
Definitely.
And we're you know what? I'm so excited that because yes, Rob and I are both Canadian, but we are very far apart.
Yep.
BC and Ontario aren't close, and I'm so excited to
it's New York, LA, pretty much.
Yeah, exactly. So
Chicago and LA.
I'm so excited to meet Rob. I'm so excited to meet everybody face to face. The guys from the Nerd Room. Rob, any last thoughts for this show about our friend?
You were mentioning the Intergalactic Con. I still have the stickers that he gave me. I can't figure out how to put these damn things on, but I'm just trying to put it on my – I have my box where I keep my my scout trooper gear for the 501st. And he was the first person to give me a challenge coin. It was an Intergalactic Con challenge coin. Now, technically, it's not official 501st coin, but it is the first challenge coin I ever got. And if you know the 501st, you know how important challenge coins are. I actually do a video on it, just a slight plug, but I've got a troop in about 2 hours out in a park, just about a couple minutes from where I live. Pause for a cause, or it'd be scaring dogs in a park, pretty much dressed up as stormtroopers and
furries.
Yeah, exactly. little Chewbaccas and Ewoks everywhere. And I will carry his coin, and it's the very first challenge coin I got, and if I can figure out how to get these damn stickers on the box, I'll be putting those on too.
Nice. But,
I think about him often, and I do miss him. But he's with me. His messages are with me. His lessons are with me. And that is the way to live forever.
Absolutely. Yeah. Riley, anything before we sign off? I know you said it best just a couple seconds ago, but no, you're good.
I mean, I love the guy. That's it. I love you guys. That's I'm going to say that.
So. Yeah, and again, it just closing thoughts.
Yeah,
I'm upset that I only got a little bit of time with him. I'm upset that now it's like this. You meet this great person, and then it's like, well, now I got to. How many more laps around the sun I got to do without this? Now I can't even talk to my friend anymore. Mm-hmm. I'm so grateful for everybody, for the Commonwealth and everybody online and everybody that reaches out on Twitter. I recently finished the static model. I'm in the Astromech Build Club. Rob knows what I'm talking about. He finished his armor. I reached out to everybody and I made this short video. I'm like, my R2's done and it's in my garage. Now, again, I'm working on the guts a little bit, but it's R2's. R2 lives at my house now, and the love that I got back was just like it's for those not in the know, don't know, but those that know what I'm talking about. And to our friends at the San Diego Sabres, I want to mention, and I'm going to mention this. I hope I'm not speaking out of turn. I'm surely not. From us at the council at the Star Wars Commonwealth. Whatever you need, whatever we can do for anybody from the San Diego Sabres radio podcast, we are here for you. Whether it's just a text, a phone call, want to meet online, I know Steve was a huge part of running that show. And if you want to podcast yourself, anything you need, technical help, whatever, anything. It could be like I said, just a text. Our door is always and will forever be open to our friends in San Diego. And
yes,
and
it will.
And if there's anything we can do, I know it's moot, and I know it's a lot of people say that when in times like this, but we're very serious and we're very genuine, and we want this. Like, if they're, please let us know, and we're grateful for all our friends in the Commonwealth, and we're so happy. And San Diego Sabres will always be and forever part of the Commonwealth, regardless of what you guys decide to do in the future. So again, thank you for introducing us to our new and now one of our old friends, Steve. So until the next time on the TSW Roundtable, again, thank you everybody for listening. And this is one of those things. This has been therapeutic for the three of us on the show. Hopefully we're going to have some, a few more messages I'm going to tack on at the end of the show from people that could not join us today, but I'll play them after we sign off here. And again, for Riley and Rob X from the Generation Podcast, thanks for listening. And we'll see you next time. Bye.
May the force be with you.
Take care.
Hey, it's Kyle from Tumbling Saber. Just wanted to say one last piece about Steve, who we already miss so very much. I guess the best thing to say at this point is that I hope we as a podcasting community can honor his legacy, which to me represents generosity of spirit, giving, friendship, and just being kind. Just being a good, solid person to whoever he met and whoever came across his path. He had a warmth of spirit about him that, frankly, I think this world needs a lot more of, not less of. So, to Steve, thank you for all that you did for myself and, of course, for the Star Wars Commonwealth and for all the many people who you have touched in your life. May you find peace and may the Force be with you always.
What's up, Steve? Steve, my man. I am not feeling great because it took me so long to record this. I think I said that I was just busy. I'm traveling and doing this. I have a conference. Can't get to it. And I think I was just avoiding it because I didn't really know exactly what to say. I still don't really know exactly what to say, but I'm hoping I can get there by the end of this little recording. And Rob, thanks for your patience and letting me get this put on tape to give to you to include. I really appreciate it, and I don't know. Yeah, it's just something that's really hard to talk about. And you know, Mopar and I decided not to do an episode and about this, and not to bring this up for a number of reasons. And I hope that doesn't sound disrespectful. We have the utmost respect for Steve and who you are as a person, and the impact that you had with our little community of Star Wars podcasts, and specifically the Commonwealth. I think we really just didn't know what to say. So we, in our smaller group, in our smaller circle, I feel like we talked about this, we paid our respects, and you know, we're really miss you, man. And again, I regret not saying anything major about it. I don't know. Posting a public statement, do I post something on Instagram? Does that have any impact? What does that mean if we do that? And am I an ass for not doing that? I don't know. This is something that's not easy to say, and it's still kind of not 100% crystal clear of, you know, exactly what happened. So we felt unsure about what to do. And in that moment, we just decided not to do anything. And I do have a little bit of regret for that. So hopefully right now I can say a few things to kind of dig myself out of that. But, you know, Steve Kirk was an amazing guy. Every time I met him was 100% positivity, 100% enthusiasm about everything that he was doing, whether it was the Saber Club, whether it was the podcast, whether it was a conference he was planning, or events that we were hosting at Celebration, or whatever it might be. I feel like he just always did everything with an air of positivity, always with an air of humor, and he always did everything to the nine. 100%, he went all in on everything that I saw him do. And I never had the chance to hang out with Steve and with our man Fode at the same time. But every single conversation I've ever had with Fode from Starbucks about Star Wars or about podcasts has always come back to Steve. Every time I talk to Riley, we always bring up Steve. And I think that just goes to show the kind of impact that he had in our small community. And I wasn't 100% involved with the other members of the podcast and his group of friends in the Saber Club down in San Diego. But if what I gleaned from talking to Fode and talking to Riley and the rest of our small community here in the Commonwealth, if that holds true to the rest of his life and the rest of his community, I have to say that everybody is really reeling from this. And he had a giant impact on everybody that he came with, that he talked to, that he hung out with. So you will be missed, my friend. I know we had a lot of things in the books for, you know, what we were going to do later this year, what we were going to do at Celebration Anaheim. And, you know, I wish we had maybe started moving on some of that stuff a little sooner. Wish we had not drug our feet on trying to get some of that stuff together. I wish I had reached out more. I wish I had said something more open, maybe. I don't know. I don't want to go down a rabbit hole of I should have done this, should have done that. But I will try to live out the humor and positivity of Steve in every future thing that we do in podcasting, in Star Wars, in community building. And I know our friends that also knew Steve and also had the same kind of reactions and same kind of interactions with him are going to try to do the same thing as well. So you are a testament to Star Wars creators, to Star Wars fans, podcasters, saber enthusiasts, martial artists in this space. And you will be missed and you will be remembered, my friend. So I love you. I miss you already. And I hope this does you some justice, my friend. I'm cracking one open for you. Drop the caribou. I'm telling you.